Hi, hello. Hi, good evening. Hello. So good evening, everyone. On behalf of Art at America Society, we would like to welcome you tonight to the Chilean Artists in New York public program. We present first a keynote by Jennifer McColl Crozier on Sylvia Palacios Whitman of, and following the keynote, Palacios Whitman will join Cecilia Vicuña and Marcelo Montealegre on a conversation about their experiences immigrating to the United States under Chilean heritage, as well as the art scene of New York in the 60s and 70s. The conversation will be moderated by the co-curator of the exhibition, Rachel Remick. We would like to thank the Ministry of Cultures, Art, and Heritage of Chile, who are supporting this public program, and particularly Jimena Moreno, Carolina Martinez, and Florencia Lowenthal for their efforts. The Sylvia Palacios Whitman To Draw a Line with the Body exhibition would not be possible without the generous support of the Jax and Natasha Hellman Foundation, the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, the New York State Council on the Arts, and the Ministry of Culture, Arts, and Heritage of Chile, of course. We would like to thank the sponsors, as well as Jennifer McColl Crozier, Sylvia Palacios Whitman, and everyone for joining us tonight. I will introduce McColl Crozier, and then let's start her presentation. Jennifer McColl Crozier holds a Master's of Philosophy and Performing Arts Research from Brunel University in London, England. Her work has delved into issues related to body and technologies, the sense of smell and the visual arts. She's the artistic and executive director of NAVE and director of Carmen Bouchard's archive. She's also co-founder of the Center for Arts and Research, CIMAE, with whom she has published books like Danza Independiente en Chile, Reconstrucción de una Escena, 1990-2000. One of the most important scholars on the work of Palacios Whitman, McColl Crozier, is also author of books like Carmen Bouchard, Modernism and Vanguardia, published in 2010, Cuerpo y Visibilidad, Reflexiones en torno al Archivo, and Pequeñas Máquinas de Conciencia, La Obra de Sylvia Palacios Whitman, published in 2020. Thank you very much, and I will give you the stage. Thank you, Jenny.
Hello. Yes, can you hear me? How are you? Good, thank you. I'm good too. Thank you for asking. Well, they asked me to do this keynote on Sylvia, which is a bit difficult for me because I know Sylvia very well. And because she is so great and so funny and such a great artist, and her artwork is being presented downstairs, and also she's gonna be here tonight with us, I didn't want to do something too academic or boring. Not working, this, Carla? Oh yeah. Okay, so instead of, you know, talking about all the theory that I wrote in the book or blah, 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 I'm gonna tell you the story of how we met with Sylvia Palacios Whitman. This is a story told by me, of course. Sylvia perhaps will have a different story. So I knew she existed, but I couldn't find anything, you know, online. I'm talking about 2005, 2006, for example. I knew she existed because I have been working with other artists that live in New York in the 70s. And a lot of people told me there was this crazy, crazy lady that did some, you know, weird stuff in the 70s. Some people call it dance. Some people call it, you know, visual, but not really visual, more movement. And then suddenly someone started calling it performance art, which in the 70s, it wasn't such a, you know, very well-known thing, the concept of performing arts. And then I tried to research, I went to different archives and places here in New York. I couldn't find much, just a note from Robert Rauschenberg saying that her work was great, but I was very intrigued because, you know, Sylvia comes from Chile. but not only from Chile, but from the very south of Chile. And she was doing crazy stuff like this. I was like, how is it possible that this person from Osorno in the very south of Chile moved to New York in the end of the 50s, early 60s, danced with Trisha Brown, knew all these people that I know, but I don't know her and I couldn't get in touch, you know? So again, she's drawing crazy and beautiful stuff. And every now and then I could, you know, get some images. People were telling me, you know, she used to throw herself into the wall, like with a slingshot. This is a slingshot piece from 1975 that Sylvia did with the design and help of Bernard Kirschenbaum, I believe, if I'm not wrong. Correct. Okay. Please, Sylvia, correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. So yeah, I was, you know, kept wondering and looking, and nothing online, nothing in Chile, nothing in New York, nothing. I was like, this is not possible. Did she disappear? Maybe. So who is this crazy lady, I wonder? Where is she? How is it possible I don't know her? Can I talk to her? Does she live in New York? I had so many open questions, but no answers at all. So I found some press clippings. And in the press clippings, there was some little, you know, description of Sylvia's pieces. And some of them were calling, it's like a moving painting. Some others was like, it's like a still dance. So, you know, she was like in between something, and people were telling all kind of crazy things about her. Because I was trying to find more stuff, I found some stuff that people said at the time in the late 70s and early 80s about her pieces that really got me thinking and wondering even more. Like Palacios Whitman experiments with what is between the lines as a documentary that slips itself a little LSD now and then. History with hallucinations. I was like, come on, please. I wanna, you know, see that. Give me that. I mean, I'm researching a lot of artists that, I mean, moved from Chile to the New York in the 60s. And she's talking about LSD, history, documentaries, and hallucinations. I want to know more. And then another quote by Sally Baines that said, Sylvia Whitman's performances, vignettes, are like tiny machines of consciousness, phantasmagoria manufactured out of ordinary things. I don't know if you saw the exhibition downstairs, but you saw paper, you saw simple materials brought into this phantasmagoric ideas, no? So, I don't know, out of this, I took this idea of tiny machines of consciousness a bit forward in time, and I brought it into the book. I'm gonna show you later. So, the call. One day I was in Chile and I learned that Trisha Brown passed away. So I got a call from a nephew of Sylvia that lived in Chile. And he says, I'm a nephew of Sylvia Palacios Whitman. And I'm like, are you kidding me? I've been looking for her for a long time now, you know? And well, Sylvia wanted to get in touch with Carmen because she also danced with Trisha, blah, blah, blah. Long story short, we got in touch. So I call her and I say, Sylvia, my name is Jennifer. I do this and that. I want to get to know you. I want to talk to you. And probably I want to write a book about you. And she was like, a book? Nobody knows about me in Chile. Like, why are you going to do that? You know, why is it relevant? And I'm like, because your work is incredible and amazing. And I do want Chilean people to know it. So we met and I started working on this book. This book that I have here, that it's called Tiny Machines of Consciousness, you know, the work of Sylvia Palacios Whitman, Pequeñas Máquinas de Conciencia, because in some point her performances, that's what they do, you know, they bring a, like a dream of consciousness or hyper-conscious, you know, to you, like a flash of of an idea or an image, and then they disappear like a dream again, you know? So we started working about this. It took me a few years because maybe you know Sylvia, maybe you don't, but she doesn't like talking about her work too much. She's rather have fun, usually. So what we did is I traveled from Chile to here, prepared some interviews and photographs and showing her material and trying to get something out of her. And she was like, that's boring, Jennifer. Let's have a drink. Let's talk about it tomorrow, maybe another day. So it took me a few years to write this book. And then Julie. Julie was a key part of this research because Julie, she's sitting right here. She is also a fantastic person. And she was like, you know what, Jennifer? I think I have some things in my place. So I went to her place in New Jersey, and her house is amazing, you know, crowded with art pieces everywhere. And in between everything, she was like, I'm going to copy this in your hard drive. And eventually I had a lot of material on Sylvia. You know, she had everything, like press clippings and all the videos, or a lot of them, and some photographs, I don't know, interviews, some stories that Sylvia wrote that nobody knew she wrote. So a lot of the mystery was solved thanks to Julie. So thank you, Julie. Without you, this would be not possible. I mean, not even this exhibition today. So, and then another person came into the picture, Talo. Talo, it's another story because Talo, is he here? Talo is here? No, but he performed for the opening. Talo not only built the leaf, but he performed the leaf, that piece, and the piece that you can see the videos downstairs. But also he created these massive, huge, and beautiful, how can I call them? Origami costumes or something, you know? So Sylvia comes up, as usual, with an idea. She wants some origami figures to dance tango. How can you make that possible? Talo, you know? So she searched for someone. Talo came up, and he's a Japanese artist. He works with paper. Perfect. There you have it. After many months of working, folding paper, unfolding paper, and then the piece was done, and it was presented here, and the music was done by Diego, that is over there. So thank you, Diego, as well. And this piece was also presented in the exhibition in Chile later on. So that's a little bit of how she works, I think, Sylvia, you know? She comes up with an idea, she doesn't quit, she just finds the right person to do it and bring it to life. And I think that's something very amazing about her, that is not only about making like big pieces of art, but making something normal, like paper, creating something special, like origami tango figures that really dance for you. Then, you know, we're friends, so we keep sending each other, you know, photographs and stuff like, yeah, I'm having a drink here. Oh, I'm having a drink over here. Oh, I hope you enjoy oysters. Yes, I'm enjoying my lunch, blah, blah, blah. Normal things, like everyday things, you know? So one day I'm on a plane from India to Chile, very long plane. I was very boring. I saw this lady next to me. I sent a picture to Sylvia, and that's what she did, you know, with it. And now that drawing is part of one of her pieces. So again, something very ordinary, like a lady sitting next to me on a plane, it comes part of a piece, you know? So it's like, it comes to life, or it has a different life, you know, after Sylvia take it, you know, with her. And then, you know, because we're friends, and maybe here I'm oversharing a little bit, how do you press play? that's vacuuming the garden. Do you have friends like that? Well, I do. And she's great. But I think that's actually why we kept sharing things every day. And we came up with I came up with the idea, and I kind of forced Sylvia into it, of having an exhibition in Chile at the National Center for Contemporary Art, which is the next airport, used to be the National Airport, which is the place where Sylvia flight to New York in the 50s, or well, to Mexico really, but in the 50s or something. 59, you see? So at the same place that she took off to, you know, fly to Mexico at that time, we were having the first solo exhibition of Sylvia and the first exhibition of Sylvia's work in Chile. So people in Chile got to see Sylvia's performances and drawings and other pieces over 40 years later, you know, which for me, it's a big something. It's big. It's important, I think. And in that exhibition, we recreated some of the performances, like this one, for example, Curve and Weight, that some of the pieces that never have been done before or redone before, you know? So Curve and Wave, for example, this is the drawing, you know, where she thinks of an idea, she makes the drawing, and then it comes to life in 75, and then we recreate it in 2021. Different performer, you know, but the same idea, and trying to actually restage every piece with the materials that were done in the 70s. This, for example, is Bed. And for this one, we only had the drawing made by Sylvia in the 70s that it says standing up bed. It's small, person in the bed, blue neon line shaping the figure, white pillow, something else, and go across the room. So we recreated that piece that you see over there, with the blue neon silhouette, and that was a bed that it was moving in the room, you know. It was not done like the actual original one, but close enough, I will say. But the thing is that the only thing we had for this recreation of this piece, for example, was that we had this drawing and we had Sylvia's memory, you know. Then, you know, we put up some of the images and also some of the drawings for the exhibition. We performed Human Paper Call, that it was done here as well. And then some of the things that really caught my attention were some like operations she does. For example, the jumping. A lot of her drawings were about jumping or moving up, you know. So we recreate some of the drawings from her notebooks in the walls for the exhibition, but also we took some of the drawings she did for Jump Up the Pyramid, and we recreated the piece with one of the performers, Francisca Espinosa from Chile. But when I told her that we were going to do that piece, she told me, not possible. We have to do it several times, and nobody picked up the first piece. Yes. Jumper, and for Francisca because she's really great. I remember Sylvia's face when she traveled to Chile and she saw this piece done and she was like, I can't believe we made it. Like, you know, like it was something a bit impossible to redo. So that's, I mean, the same piece, but with the public. And that's a bit, little bit of the first floor of the exhibition. I'm showing you this not to talk about the exhibition, but to talk about something that I think it's relevant about Sylvia's work. That is that, for example, in the first floor of this exhibition, what we did is was present most of the pieces that we thought were relevant regarding materials, you know, the paper, the pyramid, the platforms, the... board, thank you, the board, you know, the curve and weight board, and like that it has to do with the relationship between the material and the body, you know, and we actually created the image that we wanted to create, you know, of the this like a woman standing on top of the pyramid. So that was actually fantastic, and a fantastic moment of the exhibition. And then another thing that came up, you know, regarding this idea of materials and how Sylvia works with different ideas, it was the idea of the forest. Because within the notebooks, I saw this page that it says, it's a note that Sylvia wrote to Bernie, you know, saying, I want you to do me a tree that moves. And I found it fascinating, you know, like a tree that can move, but it's a question, but it's also a question like, can you do it? Can you actually give me a tree that moves? So she created this piece that is called With a Tree in 1980, With a Tree That Moves. And we recreate the piece, for the exhibition as well. With the tree that moves, actually. I love this tree because I think it's a kind of a duet between the tree and Sylvia in the moment. Here with another tree. that's the end of the original performance. But what we added that time is that base, the floors, so you keep the tree in the place as a kind of a sculpture as well. So that floor became a very, very weird forest, actually, because trees started to appear and disappear and move all around, you know, and also the leaf that you can see downstairs was also performed here and part of the what we did. So, you know, you had all the kind of views like this one within this room, you know. And the second part of what it really caught my attention, it was this phrase that I don't really know how to translate, but it's part of this drawing that she did for Maruja. Maruja was the original performer of this performance. And it says, no pude amar en cada ser un árbol. Something like, I couldn't love in each being a tree. I don't know how to translate it really, you know, because it's really poetic, but it has to do with, I think, the relation. Okay. Wow, I didn't know that. Oh, so it comes from Pablo Neruda. Now I know that. First time I hear about it. You see, I need to write another book now. But I mean, for me, this, I mean, when Sylvia described this piece to me, she talked about the endless tree, you know, that a tree that goes on and on, so it never ends, actually. This is a really bad video of that piece, but it's very short, so I'm not going to bother you with, you know, bad images for a long time. But I only wanted to give you the idea that that tree was hanging, you know, along with the other tree that appear in the room after being danced, you know, with. And so it was a beautiful forest that we create out of Sylvia's performances and images. And also to finish this part of the forest, she created another piece in English that it's called Places Reserved for the Last Standing Trees in the Forest. It has different, you know, possibilities, wood, forest, places, spaces. But at the end, we came up with the translation in Spanish. And this one has sound. So if we could have the sound, that would be great.
Standing by the everyman, digging the rigging on my sail. Rain fell to sounds of harpsichords, to the spell of fairy tale. The heath was hung in magic mists, enchanted, dripping glaze. Taste the tastes until my mind trips from this scene and fades in the night time. Crystals sparkle in the grass, I polish them with thought. My lash there in my eye, a star of light is caught. Fortunes told in grains of sand, here I am, is all I know. Can be stuck in children's hair, everywhere I go, whoa, whoa, in the night time, in the night time. Gypsy is the clown of love, I paint.
That's it. Then Sylvia went over there, she performed the Green Hands and Cap and Tail, that probably you already know because, you know, it's been so famous. And everybody wants the green hands and it's so lovely. And we had an amazing time together again. So I think that's why I started talking about how we met and how we became friends, because what we did over there with the exhibition and what we did with the book and what has been done here, you know, with her first solo exhibition in New York, and with this, and, you know, leaving traces about what she has been doing, it's only been possible because we trust each other and because, you know, we are kind of like crazy together and have a lot of fun together. So yeah, that's it. That's, I think that's what I have to say. Thank you.
Hi. So I will introduce the second part of the program, and then I will invite all the panelists to come to the stage. Perfect. So yes, let me introduce the speakers, Sylvia, Cecilia, Marcelo, and Rachel. I would like to share first Sylvia's bio. Sylvia Palacios Whitman is a visual and performance artist who studied painting and sculpture at the Escuela de Bellas Artes at the University of Chile in Santiago. After moving to New York City in 1961, Palacios Whitman began experimenting with avant-garde. In the early 1970s, she performed with Trisha Brown's Dance Company and began directing and choreographing her own performances, which is staged at art venues in the city, including The Kitchen, Artist Space, and Sanaben Gallery. From 1980s onward, she began to focus on producing drawings, collages, and sculptural artworks made from paper, expanding on visual themes from her performances, which we emphasize in this exhibition downstairs. Cecilia Vicuña is a visual artist, poet, filmmaker, and activist based in New York. Her poetic work in space, performance, and visual art is considered a decolonizing vision that anticipates ecofeminism. In recent years, she has exhibited widely in institutions such as Tate London and the Guggenheim Museum in New York, MoMA Museum of Modern Art, Documenta 14 edition, among others. And the 2022, she received the Golden Lion Award at the 59th Venice Biennale. Marcelo Montealegre is a photographer, journalist, and translator born in Puerto Montt, Chile, and a resident of Manhattan since 1968. He worked as a freelancer photographer in many publications, including Time, Newsweek, and the Houston Post, and has covered many important social and political events in Latin America and the US, such as the Argentine military coup. After moving to New York in 68, he met many Chilean and Latin American artists that defined both his work and life. With the 1973 military coup in Chile, Montealegre began engaging in activism against the dictatorship in New York, having organized numerous meetings with Chilean activists in the city and documenting their practices. There is going to be a reception after this conversation, and the galleries are going to be open in case you would like to see again and visit and see for the first time or the 10th time our exhibition, Sylvia Palacios Whitman, To Draw a Line with the Body, co-curated by Rachel Remick. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. Thank you to these artists for being here with us. And thank you, Jennifer, for your wonderful talk. I apologize, I have my notes on my phone, so bear with me. But Jennifer also contributed an essay to our pocketbook. So please make sure you get a chance to check out the book and the exhibition downstairs, as Carla mentioned. We're thrilled to have the occasion to bring together these three incredible artists, Cecilia, Sylvia, and Marcelo. And this panel is called Chilean Artists in New York. So I just have a few questions to get the conversation going, but really we're here to hear from them about their experiences living and working in New York, moving here from Chile. So my first question is super simple. When did you each first arrive in New York? And what was your impression of the city when you got here? And maybe Cecilia, you're sitting closest to me, so if you want to answer first and we can see, and then feel free to talk to each other. I have more questions as we go.
Well, the first time I came to New York was, I believe, in the year 65 as an exchange student. And I was on my way back to Chile because I did a hunger strike in order to return to Chile because I did not want to stay here. But then many years after that, I was living in Bogota and I was invited to perform in a poetry festival in Tallahassee. And when word went to Marcelo Montealegre, you had the Taller de Broadway, who it was a sort of hub for poets in exile. And I don't know how you heard of me or I heard of you, and you invited me to come to New York. So Marcelo, you were the cause I came to New York. And so that was in 1980. And I came here for just a few days to give this poetry reading. And a few days after I arrived, I think after 4 days, I met someone who happened to be a friend of Sylvia's husband. Yes. And so I also met Sylvia. She doesn't remember because it was a tragic moment, but I remember her. And so I ended up staying my life here because this gentleman said, let's get married. So that's my story.
Okay. Okay, so first, I was very young in Chile. I had just been to Escuela de Bellas Artes, but only for a few months, really. I think they had had it with me as soon as I got there. But after I got married to Enrique Castrocito at the time, we left Chile and went to Mexico City to visit his father, with absolutely no intentions of coming to America at all. At the time, like in the late 50s, in very early 60s, I think that still young people had an idea that it would have been a great idea to go to Paris, because Paris was still, you know, Europe or something fantastic, great artists and whatnot, and so that's what we were gonna do. But we ended up in America because Enrique's father from Mexico wanted to change his cars. He had this thing of changing his cars every year. So we went with him to America and put the change of his cars, and we ended up staying forever. And we never went to Europe. Well, we went after, but not really at the time. And we arrived maybe 1960, that I can remember, to New York City in a very snowy day, and it was freezing. And we didn't have money, we didn't know where we were, what we were doing. And somehow I found it very accommodating. And we went one step for another in getting involved and stuff and whatnot. Next thing we know, this is where we wanted to stay. And I'm still here. Yeah, that's how it went.
Hello. And I came the first time to New York in 1967, invited by Life magazine, because they had a project of creating a Spanish version of the magazine that was more attuned to the realities of the continent. What they had at the time was just simply a translation of the main English version. And I stayed here for 5 months, and I was absolutely fascinated from the beginning, not only by the city itself, the big buildings, the amount of people, but what really got me from the beginning was the diversity of people, the way they were so free in every aspect that we were not free in Chile, who was always and still is a very, very conservative society. And then, so during that time, I did the most walking I've done in my whole life. Walking the fantastic thing that I found was that I could walk a few blocks and be in a completely different world. The different kinds of people, Spanish, from different countries that I had not been in, and also knew so little about them, I started to know them through the people here in New York. So then when I went back to Chile, as it was part of the idea, with the knowledge that the program that they had was not going to happen, and it didn't, they started closing all the magazines, as we all know. I went back to Chile almost as an exile, and my wife at the time thought I was going crazy, and I think she was right. I knew that I had to come back to New York, and I did to cover the election in 1968 of when Nixon was elected, and through some of the people I had met during the 1967, they were working, especially at Chilean, Jaime Barrios. They offered me a job with very little money, but it was something that I grabbed it immediately. So I stayed. I stayed here, and I called my wife, Doris, and just told her, listen, just make up all your bags because we are coming to New York and gonna stay here. And she was, took her a long time to believe that. We were already pretty well set up in Santiago. So it was a huge, for a change for her, for our daughter Ingrid. So that's more or less why and when I came to New York.
Thank you so much, all three of you. And then my next question is that you all were, you know, studying art, making art, or working in each of your trades in Chile before moving to New York. And I'm curious to know if you feel that your move to New York and living in New York changed the way you made art, expanded your ideas about your art, or if it had an effect in that regard. I don't know if there's anyone in particular that wants to start first.
I suppose every move changes everything. And especially in New York, I really never intended to live in New York, but when I found myself in New York, first thing that happened to me is that I didn't have a studio. And so I began working in the streets. So the streets of Manhattan became my studio. And I started to do precarious installations, just as I had done in the beaches or in the mountains in other places. I started to do them in the sidewalk. And then people would step on them the way the ocean, it would erase the work that I did in the beaches, or the way the wind dissolved them in the mountains. And I really loved that, the fact that the movement of the bodies of people in the street was very much like the movement of the waves or the movement of the rivers. And so I suppose my sense of what was possible expanded to the limitless scale because of the violence of New York against people like me. And so I encountered this tremendous rejection by the regular people, and also a tremendous embrace by really wonderful artists that I met here. And I had not been here for a few weeks, and I already met Lucy Lippert, and she invited me to join the Heresies Collective. So from one minute to the next, I was working with this amazing group of women. So this tremendous contrast that New York is welcoming to new ideas, to new spirit, and at the same time violent because you are little and dark. And so that was tremendously energizing for me.
Broken? No, it's okay. It's okay. I found New York an exceptional place when I arrived here. I just felt like we fit it, and it was perfectly, it was like a jacket that fits you real well. You just grab it and put it on, and the jacket keeps you warm, and it just worked very, very well. And also the people that you met at the time in the early 60s. I mean, come on, those musicians, the Beatles, going to their concerts and seeing them, and each time adding to your life. And I think that everything you do obviously gets you more involved in what you're doing and changing and whatnot. So I found that this America was something very, very special. I do remember that we didn't have very much money, but it didn't make all that much of a, we just eat less. And I had very bad ideas at the time because I still loved animals in New York, and I went and I discovered that there was a monkey in the store. In the store, and my grandmother has sent me as a big thing from Chile, $100. And so I walked into the store, and I said to the guy, we were very poor at the time with my first husband, and I asked the guy in the store, how much was that monkey? And he said, about 120 or. It was more than what I had, and I said, too bad, I only have $100. And as I'm walking out, he says, just a minute, you can have it for that money. And he put the monkey in the box. Who did that? And I arrived home at the Lower East Side that we lived in, this tiny little place and whatnot. And of course, it was unbelievable what the person that my husband at the time looked at me, you brought a monkey? We have not a penny to eat, and you are adding a monkey to but he, see, there's always something good you can get of something bad. So there were people in the street walking, and I used to go out with my monkey and pet my monkey. They all had a great interest in the monkey. They wanted to pet him and whatnot. At the same time, the people selling bananas gave me bananas for the monkey. And the people selling fruit gave me fruit for the monkey. I took all this home, and my husband and myself ate the food. So the monkey was letting us eat. Yeah. So, I mean, and then New York went like that from one thing to another. It was always something big that happened to me. I thought everybody went through the same thing, but the same thing happened to me when I remember Marta's first wife that we had met at the time. She said, look, one of you have to work here, or the two of you are really going to starve. And so my first husband, of course, looked at me immediately because he says, look, I'm the great artist. You are going to have to do something. So Anna said, I think I can find you a job. Let me see what I can do. And I spoke very, very little English. Not that my English is so good now, but at the time, forget about it. And so she got me, I don't know what she did, but she called me the following day and she says, I have a job for you, I think. I mean, somebody wants to help you. I said, good. And this woman wanted me to her place in a big building, Madison Avenue or one like that. I walked in there. Her name was Gina Machado, and she spoke Spanish because she was from, I don't know where, but she was working, obviously, for the magazine. Next thing I know, she puts me in a taxi. She takes me up these great avenues and whatnot. We stopped in the middle of a big building. She opened the door, and there is this little short man who says, okay, come on in here. And he says, walk this way. And I said, what kind of a job is this? Walk this way, walk that way. And he pushed my face like this and pushed my head like that. And he said, take it in there. They took me in there, they put makeup in my face, makeup, they did my hair, they put this hat with feathers and furs. And about a week after that, they called me up and they said, you are going to be in the cover of Harper's Bazaar. Can you believe it? I said, I'm going to be in the cover of Harper's Bazaar. What is Harper's Bazaar? Number one. And the guy was Richard Avedon, the photographer. Can you believe it? It was unbelievable. And so I brought my mother and my father, and I said, I don't know exactly what Harper's Bazaar is, but I'm going to be on the cover. And my mother wrote back saying, you watch out, young lady. I don't want to hear that you're the prostitute. So it's things like that happened to me. On top of me, of course, doing my art, but all of it was related with that thing. There was for me nothing that brought me up. I was just doing whatever, you know, doing all my craziness and stuff. And I didn't do any more modeling after that. But they did pay me so that not to show in other covers. They just wanted me to be in that cover. So for about a month and a half or two, we ate pretty well. And of course, there was no other magazine asking me to, but we were eating well. So, and as far as the art is concerned, I just do it in the middle of the night. Usually, I get these crazy ideas, get up and do it. And all you've seen what she showed you. And I think I'm using all this time. It's your turn. It's your turn, I think.
Okay, the first impact in my work that I found in the fact that I came to New York had to do with resources available here. In Chile, it was a constant struggle to find the material, incredibly expensive, and the quality, especially of the chemicals that I needed to develop the film, was always changing, so there was never any consistency. And then in New York, it was the opposite. The availability of material things is absolutely different from what it was in Chile at the time. Besides that, as I mentioned before, the fascination that I had with the city itself impacted me in my work, and I soon started connecting to different photo agencies, which was a way at the time to sell your work. And it was all being very successful, going in the right direction. You may have seen before one of the pictures of the loft, the first loft that we had in Warren Street, very near Municipal Park, City Hall. And to do that, I had to learn everything: electricity, carpentry, plumbing, painting. And I had to do that myself. I didn't have the resources to pay anybody to do that. And there again, my wife was also something incredible in that sense. She learned how to use all kinds of machines, and she was essential, plus a couple of friends in the building of the loft. The same thing happened when we moved to the big loft in Broadway, which was an incredibly magnificent place, and we lived there for 23 years on Broadway. So the big change in my work came in 1973, when the military in Chile took over the government. The president, who had been elected in a completely clean election, died, and a dictatorship, one of the most brutal dictatorships in Latin America, and that is saying a lot, was instituted. And obviously, it affected every Chilean everywhere, wherever they were. So groups were formed here, New York, very quickly. At the beginning of that, my attitude was sort of blasé. It's another, unfortunately, Chile has joined the rest of Latin America in having a military coup. But it was soon evident that this was a difference because of its brutality and the obvious intention of staying in power forever. So in sort of an unconscious way, I started getting away from the kind of job that I was doing with the agencies and devoting more and more time to the work that we were doing as a group against the junta. And of course, my contribution to that was photography, which I had to do in a voluntary way, because again, there were no resources for paying for anything. Most of the work was done voluntarily. And as soon as the refugees started coming, I started getting more and more involved with them, with their experience. And of course, I photographed all that. So something that happened very far away had a direct impact on my work here, my life. I had more or less decided, which I think is more normal also, to distance myself from Chile, my experience there, the difficulties I had there, and the opportunities that were open here. Because of this situation the political situation that affected all of us here in New York. Many groups were formed of different kinds of political inclinations, and there was a lot of work to do. And we did it. We did as much as we could. We were very successful in the United Nations. Right here in the audience, I can see one of the persons who work in the United Nations. Yeah, he's also getting old, just like me. But I have to say that in spite of the difficulties I encountered, and as a person, as an artist, it was incredibly exciting because there was something that could be done, and we did it with all our hearts, with all our efforts. I worked as a dishwasher, as a cook, as a waiter in the restaurant, just doing the whole thing. My wife also, she got jobs that she wouldn't have dreamed in Chile. She eventually created one of the best nursery schools in the city of New York, recognized by the city. So things in that sense, there was obviously a sense of being very, very much alive. And that was something that is very, very important. As my family grew, we needed obviously to continue doing this, and even more so. And as the years started piling up on us, we had to slow down, obviously. But I'm still very active in photography and working in my archive mostly, which right now is over 120,000 pictures. So I still have a lot of work to do. And I'm very happy doing it. And I hope to live at least to 100, if not more. I do have an aunt right now who is alive. She is 104 years old. So I do have some hope. And well, I think I better stop there because I tend to continue forever. So
thank you, Marcelo. I think your answer kind of drifted toward my last prompt. So I'll give Sylvia and Cecilia a chance to answer about the experience of making artwork, you know, far away from Chile where you grew up. And you had mentioned some of the particular dimensions to that in the 70s from the dictatorship period onward. But Sylvia, too, in your work, as in your performance event, South, you reflect on the experience of living far away from your family. And a lot of those performances really have to do with that. So I wonder if, you know, I guess a more broad way of saying it is kind of how your kind of Chilean heritage shows up in your artwork being made here in New York. I don't know if Sylvia or Cecilia, you have any thoughts on that prompt, or also in relationship to what Marcelo shared about his experience living here in the 70s.
Yeah, for me, what happened to me in relation to Chile really happened when I left Chile for London when I was like 24 years old, and that was during the popular unity. At the end of the year 1972, I got a grant to study in London, and that's when the discovery of Chile really began. When I saw the incredible contrast between the infinite creativity that Chile was at the time. During the time of Salvador Allende, Chile was like an explosion of inventions of all kinds, social, collective, individual, in science, in cybernetics, you name it, you know? And so I arrived in London and I saw a city of the past. And I recently came across a text that I wrote when I had just arrived, and it's an incredibly funny description of the English people as slaves. Because they were so down like this and accustomed to that order of things where everybody is miserable. the contrast with Chile was so explosive, you know, the body memory of the joy of taking part in the transformation of society was something that still lives in me, you know. So many years go by, and suddenly I come, as I was telling you, in 1980, to give a poetry reading at Taller de Broadway that Marcelo held as a wonderful place for Chilean poets that migrating from one country to the next, looking for where to live. And so what happened to me here is that I discovered what I call the bibliography. And I discovered the depth of knowledge about indigenous and pre-Columbian America that live in America and ancient America like I had never seen in Chile. In Chile, to find Chile is a very racist country today, and it was very racist all along in the past as well. So I had a passion for everything indigenous because I decided that I must be indigenous just by my looks. My family didn't believe any of that, but thank God I eventually reconfirmed this with a DNA test when I was in my 60s. Well, in any case, the important thing is that encountering this information transformed my poetry, transformed my art, in the sense that it gave a deeper meaning to everything that I have felt and thought in my life, because the rebellion that I had embodied since I was a little girl had a meaning. And the meaning was that I felt robbed of the joy and the beauty of what we were before the conquest. So in that sense, New York really electrified me, because I can't even describe the passion I felt going to the museums and reading 4,000 books on this subject matter.
Do you have any final thoughts to add, Sylvia? I know we had mentioned a little bit, or if you want to.
Too many.
We had mentioned a little bit about. Or if you want to share a little bit about South, too.
Me lo pongo aquí?
Yeah.
No, I realized that listening to you is so interesting, the two of you, because you had this great relation with your country and then coming to America and having a different relationship, and what you did from here to them and what you did when you were there. When you were here, I didn't have any of that at all. Once I moved out of Chile, I was out. I didn't go back much at all. In fact, I think that some one time it was like 15, 20 years maybe, I didn't go back at all. And I did, instead, what I did later on was to invite them to come here, and eventually, and when and then I married this American artist called Bob Whitman, and then he's a real gringo. I hope he's not. In my family. And so I invited them here, and I took my sister to Europe and instead. And so I didn't have that relationship with Chile. I mean, I love Chile because I was born there, and I love my family, but I didn't go ever there to do artwork. And in fact, I never even told them I did. And in New York is where I and did stuff, and so I don't have. But I it's interesting. I listening. It's interesting. I'm sorry.
No, don't apologize. Thank you so much for sharing. Well, any last, any favorite? I know throughout your answers, you've gestured at the interconnections between you, Any favorite memories from New York in the 60s or 70s that come to mind that you'd like to share as we wrap up our conversation?
Are you talking to me?
All three, anyone. But Sylvia, of course.
you go ahead. Well, one of the great things about New York is you can meet Sylvia Palacios Whitman, you know. And because in Chile, there was no way that you would never hear about someone like her, like there was no way that people would ever heard about me, you see. In Chile, women artists are completely suppressed. And so it was absolutely wonderful for me when eventually I discovered your work. I think I love the title of the book that you just created, of something like Moments of Consciousness, because I feel such a profound affinity with you, Sylvia, in that you are a completely irreverent, completely playful, beyond smart artist. And so I wrote long ago, many years ago, that the real art is consciousness. And then I find the title of your book. And you see, the affinity goes to where, and this, where is it coming from? Is it from the fact that you were born in Osorno and you were a wild girl in Osorno, the way I was a wild girl in La Florida? I think there was something really extraordinary, even though you don't feel a connection. I feel you and I have a deep connection to that territory that allowed us to be wild.
Yeah, well, also my father had a tremendous sense of humor, and it was always fun to be, I don't remember, you know, since I left so young, maybe, and I never went back, I never had the chance for people there to abuse me or to, well, a couple of times, but not really, and so that, you know, my idea is I remember those lunches. I remember the silliness of my father with the, taking us to see the monkey. And that is the happy ideas. I was not involved in politics. I was aware when you were talking of what was happening in Chile and whatnot, but I wasn't involved in it. And I was not with enough Chilean people here to talk to them about it or to know much, except I could read in the newspapers and I could hear on the radio and whatnot. But otherwise, I didn't have the same. It's interesting that the three of us are Chilean and we are in a, it was so different. You know, I had no, yes, it was separate. It was a separate thing. It's like,
but you have it in you. It doesn't matter that you never go back there, you never think about it, you are it.
Of course. Let me see.
Thank God.
Yeah. Well, it's your turn, I think.
Any final thoughts, Marcel?
Hello? the sense I have in terms of the relationship within between me and my country now is that I was distancing myself, as I was saying before, and I sort of rediscovered the Chile that we all have in as our country, which is something that probably doesn't exist, has never existed. But we have a certain idea of what it's supposed to be, and that idea was shattered by the imposition of a regime that was, I keep saying, really brutal. But I also, at the same time that I rediscovered Chile, and in other words, my Chile, whatever it was in my dreams. I also discovered Latin America. We in Chile were brought up to hate or to feel superior to the other Latin American countries. I remember very clearly that there was always this myth about the hatred between the Argentinians and the Chileans, between Peruvians, Bolivians, and Chile, because they are the three countries that are surrounding Chile in our borders. And the rest of the countries in Latin America simply didn't exist. So I discovered all these countries here in New York with all the people that I met, both as a photographer in general, as a living here, the group of artists that I met at the beginning in 1967 and the one that continued when I came back in 68 was made up of Cubans, Colombians, Venezuelans, Chileans, of course, Argentinians, Puerto Ricans, you know. So it was a completely different experience, and obviously that has to impact in the way you think about things, the way you see things, and obviously then it's gonna come down to your art. The influences of those cultures started to slowly make themselves obvious. And it's one of my most cherished experiences here is the fact that I have become more of a Latin American than a Chilean. And the times I've gone to Chile, which have not been very many, I went in 1970, and then I to get my papers, and then I waited for 20 years before going back to Chile. So when I went to Chile after the junta, after the dictatorship, it was totally an amazing rediscovery of a physical Chile. All kinds of construction of building, the whole thing was materializing itself in a speed that was amazing. But also, and I think it still exists there, a sense of fear, an emptiness that you don't have here in New York, I suppose. I cannot talk about the rest of the country because I haven't lived in the rest of the country. I've lived in New York. So the work that I've been doing and the relationship with Chile is two different worlds, completely opposite almost. And what I have seen of the art in Chile, the times I've gone there, and what I can see through the internet reflects a tremendous commitment on part of the artists there to changes, to change things as what they are now to something better. And that, of course, is something that makes me hopeful and very happy. I know how difficult it is. I've learned how difficult it is. I always thought it was more possible than it really is. So I'm more united, more part of Chile right now, in spite of whatever I have said, than I ever was when I was living in Chile, because I want a different country, a different society in Chile than the one that existed at the time I was there, and the one that came after. During 3 years, we had a blink of hope that things were really going to change, and they were going in the right direction, and suddenly that was taken away in a brutal way, and Chile changed again in a way that I find extremely negative. And I'm still thinking something can be done, something must be done. We have to continue trying. That has become our life. That has become our identity. And that's it.
Well, thank you all. Thank you all for being here and sharing your experiences. And we invite everyone here to join us for a reception in the adjoining room. Thank you so much.